For now, it's time to take our first deep dive. And we're going to have our focus on the remote and island microgrids. And for that, I introduce again to you Leon Pulles, Managing Partner at Energy Investment Management. So, Leon, welcome back.
Thank you, Margien.
So, how are you doing?
I'm doing well, yeah.
Very good. So if you're looking back on the 15th session, you also had a very good presentation. What were your main conclusions of that day?
I think when we look to the whole day, then it was quite interesting to see the different areas where microgrids are used. And I think we really can learn from each other. So I think that's a nice takeaway. And when we look to today's sessions, I think also we have some very nice, interesting projects from Europe, but yeah, also from Southeast Asia. I think that are really interesting things that we like to share with the audience. And I hope that we can also inspire the military and the commercial and the industrial area with our, I think, very nice reference projects.
Yeah, well, thank you. We set up these sessions with panels, and you shared your network. So you will introduce us in a few minutes to your panelists. That's also what you bring to us, inclusive two cases. But also, what would you like to take home with you today?
I think, I think it's always nice to work together, like with the panelist. I will introduce to you shortly. Yeah. So I think by preparing for this session, we already had some very interesting talks about developments in Europe, but also developments in Asia. So I think we will really want to bring that further. And that's also something very nice for the end of the session, yeah, how we can bring that further. And also, I'm very interested in the sessions about military and commercial industrial, because there I see also some great links to bring it further.
So, very nice. Well, let's join me at the table. Now, I'm very curious at the panel you have invited for us today. Leon, please, who's with us?
Yeah, here at the table, we have Unizar.
Hi, everyone. My name is Unizar Pragistio. And at this moment, I'm representing Indonesian Energy Transition Network. It's a community of young professionals that are passionate in bringing the transition of Indonesia into a more sustainable future. And at this moment, I'm also currently working as a technical engineer in one of the manufacturing company for power solutions and navigation aids. And I'm also actively involved in the social initiatives in Indonesia.
Good.
Yeah. That's very interesting.
I'm
welcome
to the other panelists. Are they are not yet there? But maybe it's good to discuss a little bit further, Unizar, about you're involved in that Indonesian energy transition community. You see a lot of young professionals from Indonesia coming
maybe,
to Europe.
Sorry, Leon, I break in your start, because we have the connection with other panelists.
I see they are there.
They're not here with us in the studio today. Huh? They're from worldwide, but also because of COVID. Could you please introduce us to them?
Nikos, maybe you can introduce yourself. Nikos from the University of Athens, former CEO of Hetno, the distribution company in Greece. But maybe you can tell a little bit more about yourself and your involvement in the microgrid community already for a very long while.
Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. My name is Nikos Hadzi-Argyriou. I'm a professor at the University of Athens, and I have a 10-year-long experience from the utility of Greece. I was head and chairman and CEO of the LNG Distribution Network Operator. I'm also vice chair of ETIPSNET, which is the European Technology Innovation Platform for Smart Energy Networks. And I have been involved in smart energies, and especially in microgrids, for a long time. I have been leading some major European efforts in microgrids projects, and also I have written a book and several papers and researches in this field.
Thank you, Nikos.
Welcome here, Nikos.
Nice to see you.
Atem, can you introduce yourself and your company, We Energy?
Hi, everyone. Good morning or good afternoon to you. My name is Atam Ramsunder Singh. I'm now in Singapore and heading the company called We Energy Global, but also director of the investment arm of our company, which is Clean Grid Partners. And that is a joint venture with Tokyo Electric Power Corporation, Power Grid. So we are very much on dedicated on microgrids for off-grid electrification, but also microgrids for industrial estates and the new emerging towns and cities in Southeast Asia. That's what we do. We design, we build, we own, we finance, we operate these assets. So we are not neither an investment group, nor a bank, nor an engineering consultancy. We do the job because we don't want to waste time to get through big circles of designers, planners, and bankers and so on. So we have the money, we have the technology, and we go for the mission. SDG 7 and SDG 13. Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome.
Simon, can you introduce yourself and your organization, Clean Energy for EU Islands?
Yes, so I'm here to represent Clean Energy for EU Islands Secretariat. We're an initiative from the European Commission to support islands in the EU with their clean energy transition. So I think the link that we're making here, talking in a webinar on microgrid, is very relevant, since many islands, they are already non-grid connected, which means that they already have microgrids. And also recently, because of new technologies, there's a big potential on islands to be implementing innovative microgrids with renewables, with storage. And there's actually, I think, a lot of potential there. So I myself, I'm an engineer, and I also have a background in economics, and I've done research on sizing of microgrids, and also on the benefits of microgrids and how these should be distributed across different stakeholders. That's why I think what was said earlier in the introduction is the fact that there's many people that have a stake in these microgrids, creates a certain complexity, but also allows for synergies to take place. So I'm interested to go in discussion with fellow panelists.
Welcome here, thank you. So Leon, this is a really interesting panel with a lot of angles. You also prepared some cases.
Yeah.
You take us with you.
I think we have we selected two interesting cases. I hope Nathan can share them on the screen. With these two cases, we first take the Kytnos microgrid on Greece. Kytnos was one of the first movers in Europe when it's about sustainable transition. There were the first wind turbines built on the island. And there was also already in a very early stage a microgrid. I think within Europe, it is the first, of within the world, it's the first microgrid. It's a real test environment, so there is a lot of testing still going on. So there are 14 houses connected, solar, 22 kilowatt peak, a battery storage system, and also a diesel gen set. And there is a lot of developments when it's about control concepts, and it's in operation since 2001. I think it's a system that is already running there for 20 years. And the next case is the Sabang Palawan microgrid in the Philippines. It's Atom will tell in more detail. It is a more recent development. It's really a remote grid project with 1.4 megawatt peak solar, a battery system, 2.3 megawatt hour, a diesel gen set, and a smart grid of 14 kilometers and 650 off-takers. And just since last year, it's an operation. So we have, I think, the best of Europe and the best of Asia we brought together. And I think I'm really looking forward to discuss more in detail. Maybe it's good to first look to that Kytnos microgrid project. And I'd like to start with Nikos. I think you're already involved since a very long while on this project. And maybe you can elaborate a little bit more about the start of the Kitnos microgrid project and also the technology stages that you have seen and the development over the years. Maybe you can elaborate a little bit on that, Nikos.
Yes, thank you, Leon. So this is a microgrid that was built in 2001. It was a result of two European projects. And the idea was to electrify 12 at the beginning and later 14 houses. And mainly from, or purely from photovoltaics and batteries. And there is also a diesel engine that is supposed to be used only for backup. So it is the first microgrid that was really operated by 100% renewables for several, for the longest time during the year. And one important part, so there is these seven distributed PVs in various houses, and also there is a central house called the central building called the central house, where the batteries are installed and all the control equipment. And there is also a communication system running parallel to the power system. And this was used to also to control the loads. So the important thing is at the beginning there were load controllers installed that were operated based on the frequency of the island. So when the frequency was low, when the state of the charge of the batteries was low, then the diesel was operating to raise the state of charge. And when the state of charge was high, then the inverters were operating to lower the production of the PVs. In 2008, in the context of another large European project called the Mauer Microgrids project, there were seven pilot cases in Europe. One of them was Kitnos. And in that case, we installed a quite sophisticated system that was built that was using distributed intelligent agents in the various houses. And by exchanging information, also based on the status of the battery, they could on themselves decide how to curtail load. The load to be curtailed was mainly air conditioning and high power, high consumption loads. And basically it was irrigation pumps that are used for the irrigation of the houses. So by exchanging messages, the agents could decide on a fair way how to curtail load so that the operation of the diesel was minimized. So that ran quite well, used quite sophisticated technologies of wireless communication, also of agent-based technologies of CIM language and several technologies that are not really needed for such a small installation, but we use them to prove the concept, and then this could be further upgraded in larger installations. And now, at this stage, then later there was a fire that destroyed some of the photovoltaics, so we had some repair work. And now, after 20 years of operation, the batteries have been degraded. Also, photovoltaics also are not as efficient as they used to be. So now we're in the range of replacing or refurbishing the whole installation. And also, based on the lessons learned, we are introducing a more sophisticated protection system. And also, we are installing an industrial-based microcentral controller to control, again, the installation in the main purpose to have it 100% renewable penetrated, operated. So that's in very brief an overview. And of course, I can expand if you are interested in any of these cases.
I think it's a good introduction. And you also understood out of our previous conversations that you really started as a kind of design yourself, your systems, and then later you also saw that industry players were taking over, and also now this kind of products are commercially available on the market. So I think that way there was quite some interesting spin-off from this project to the broader industry. I'm right?
Yeah, I must add here that, of course, industry has moved a lot. Now you have even specifications for this, some of these components, but still there is plenty of room to for research for university to build upon this basic infrastructure and try more sophisticated techniques. So this does not mean that we stop using this place as a, I think, ideal testbed for research and for building technologies. But for sure, this combination between industrial products plus innovative research is more and more.
Simon, maybe you can reflect on that, representing the European islands. What kind of similar developments you see in Europe, also as a kind of spin-off of these developments?
So yes, thank you very much, Nikos, for your explanation. It's very interesting to see that these developments are already taking place or were already taking place 20 years ago. And that what we've seen from there on is sort of a need for upscaling these very small systems to something bigger. I think a very interesting example, and those are islands that we work with as well, are the off-grid Scottish community. So this is a group of 6 or 7 islands in Scotland, and there you see more or less similar systems. So also multiple technologies that are combined in a microgrid. So for example, Isle of Egg is one of the islands, or Fair Isle, Fula, and these are quite small. Often you don't have more than 50 inhabitants on these islands, because interconnection is too expensive. What they did all the way back in the 2000s, they started installing these first generation microgrids, and also there, what we see now. So they had innovative technologies at the time, but however, now for them it's time to go for the next step in this transition, where they're looking for more innovative or more efficient technologies that can be the next step for them in these systems. However, I wanted to ask Nikos also a question, because you say that that you were installing wind turbines and that you were installing controllers in people's houses. So I was wondering how the interaction with the households in this microgrid project that you presented, how did this go? What convinced them to take part in this trial?
Yeah, that's a very interesting dimension. Of course, imagine that you have an isolated case with no electricity, except of some local diesel. So the inhabitants first welcomed. They had to be convinced about these new installations. From the very beginning, we had to explain to them that they would use low consumption devices, so only only lamps and Class A fridges, etc. No big installations. So they had small fuses of 8 amps only. So all this was something to be persuaded. Then, one of the big problems of this installation was that at the beginning, since the capacity of the batteries was limited and also the photovoltaics, energy was not ample, so people used to somehow behave in a greedy way, trying to use as much electricity as possible. When the system was installed with agents that the various houses, the various local controllers could interact in, let's say, in an objective technical way, they would share the electricity. That was very well taken. And also, we had a panel that was displaying how the messages were exchanged, how the electricity was shared, and in a fair way, you see. So that helped a lot. Overall, people were quite happy with the installation. But I must also say that the reason why we need now to upgrade everything is because, of course, maintenance was not very good. The fact that the system was far from the mainland, and although it did not need any very sophisticated maintenance, that was neglected. So now what we are trying to do is to upgrade all the system and also increase the comfort of the houses by allowing them to install more energy intensive devices. So it's a process again. I would say that that was a serious discussion and also taught us a lot of how people can accept technology if they are persuaded, if they are discussed, and all this is very important.
Leon, I have a first question for the audience, also for Nikos, for your. There's a question who's asking, could you tell us more about the degradation of the PV and the batteries in the Kidnos microgrids? Do you have information to share with us? Degradation.
Yeah, this is what I said. There was a lack of maintenance, especially in the last period. As a result, there were two battery banks. One is destroyed upon repair, cannot be used. The second one is degraded. And also, some of the PVs, their performance has dropped significantly. I don't remember specific numbers, but I'm available if you want to know. I can find out and send you. But the maintenance and local expertise was a very big problem in this installation.
Thank you. Yeah, I think I see similar this kind of challenges when I look to Southeast Asia. There, we also see a lot of islands, a lot of remote areas where also maintenance is a very important subject. I think also what is very important, that life cycle approach. Sometimes it's very easy to do that first investment, but yeah, keep it running for the long run. I also like to go to E-Energy, to Atom. I think your project is a different scale and also built in a different time, quite recently. But maybe first start, what's your motivation to do this work? We had last week an interesting discussion. What drives you to really do this kind of projects in Southeast Asia?
Well, we started in Southeast Asia, but we are already looking over the shoulders to Sub-Saharan Africa. Our company never sleeps, keeps running simple. It is too much of one-sided attention to climate change. Our mission is to fight that climate change, but not to build huge 100 megawatts solar power plants and wind to power middle-class citizens who already have electricity in their homes. Now, we need to do that as well. Fight the climate change at all levels possible, because it is a huge crisis that is also creating things like COVID-19 and so on. So our mission is to pay attention to the 900 million people, of which around 400 million people in Asia alone have zero access to electricity. While we see Ferraris in the cities of Jakarta, while we see Rolls Royces in the cities of Manila, there are 50 million people in Indonesia without access to electricity. There are 40 million people without access to electricity in Myanmar. And there are 11 million people without access to electricity in the Philippines. So why our mission? Well, simple. Those people live under a certain level of income. And they are entrepreneurs like us. They have their dreams like us. They have their daughters and their sons who wish to change the world like us. So why not supporting them by electrifying them in a clean way, in a hybrid way, given the regulations that are not there or are there? So our mission is to really build those things, finance those things, own those things, operate those things, to use decentralized way of expanding and electrification to use the local sources that are available. No need to tell this panel. To do that in a way that it's bankable, it can be financed, and we can earn a return, a reasonable return, a fair return on our investments on there. Now, the company is a bit of an activist company because we don't go when there is a tender. We go and develop those things. We find those for people call us, mayors, governors, name it, politicians. They know how to find us and to attract our attention to a certain spot in this part of the world. So that's what we do. We mobilize the different stakeholders. We have our own engineers in Singapore. We have our staff in Myanmar, in Indonesia. We have our staff in Philippines to mobilize, including the Netherlands, by the way. We have one engineer in the Netherlands that is supporting us from there as a full-time to get this job done out there. So mission, bring sustainability to those towns and industries and villages, and make sure that we do that in a way that we also fight the climate change. Look, if we want zero emission to be achieved by 2050, let us stop talking about those huge projects alone. Let us start decentralization of electricity, which is one of the most important emitters on this planet. Once you decentralize, there is no need for coal nonsense. There is no need for diesel as a source. There is no need. The technology is already there. It's not rocket science, by the way.
Atem, also a question for you. In the mission and the vision you share with us, it's also about costs. If people have no power and it's made available, it's also about cost. Can you explain to us what you see happening there?
Yeah. So when it comes to cost, I think companies, especially those who are focused on just selling something to somebody else, right, don't work in that traditional way, because cost matters in these stages of microgrids. Imagine there is no regulation that guarantee an investor on his return. We take all the risk. We sit middle in the jungle or on an island and create an off-grid solution, which we own, we operate, we work with our local teams to do it. Now, in terms of cost, you really have to stretch your brains in all directions to find solutions that can be made affordable. So when you have your design principles from academia or from a company somewhere in Europe, stop it. Your stuff is working in Africa or somewhere in Asia because your government backed you up with free money. But when you put crowd money, where you have to return people at a 5 or a 6% interest rate back, you better make sure that your technology is the lowest cost that is possible out there. The choice of your batteries, the choice of your panels, the choice of your grid, the choice of your smart meters, everything needs to be double turned around to make sure you have the most cost-effective solution. Just selling something, that's why we don't buy from a seller of, let's say, from a company somewhere in England or America or whatever. We buy the components, we integrate the system, we hire our own contractors, we have our own staff to cut down on cost to go and do it. You can't put everything in a container and ship it from Rotterdam or Germany, Hamburg, or whatever. Yeah, you can do it when your government pays for it and fully subsidize it. No wonder those projects don't have a good lifetime because nobody cares about it as such. Our systems are designed. We bring them together on those islands where there is no port, there is nothing. So you got to have that motivation to manage the cost and cut down the cost without compromising quality. What does it mean? It means you need to have a bunch of smart people in your company who can do the impossible.
I think, Adam, it's also interesting to look at that Palawan project. Can you tell us a little bit more about the project and also the challenges that you meet when you were developing and realizing that project?
You know, if I see this webinar on microgrids and you don't have one series, you have three, or this is the fourth one, I think. I have to go back 8 years back when we launched this first idea in Southeast Asia. in Asia in general, nobody believes it. Nobody wanted to even talk to us or invite us for a conference to present storage in microgrids. Solar panels to combine with diesel, make a hybrid system. Nobody wanted to talk about it. Today we see that is happening. Now, while we move forward as technology innovators and as investors who put our money into the game, mobilize the banks, educated the banks to believe that microgrids are the future. I'm talking about 8 years back. We went to more than 10, 15 banks, including FMO in the Netherlands. You know what is that guy tell me? Oh, no, that's too risky. Your money is government money, at least part of it. You've got to support development to those 900 million people. Now they are doing it, I guess. But back then, we had to mobilize the entire, you know, environment of bankers, governments, regulators to understand that hybrids and decentralized electrification were the way to go. And we did it. We took hundreds of hours of time to educate our Philippine counterparts in the regulatory authority, in the Ministry of Energy. We really had to pave the way, educate our future negotiators to then come and kill us in the negotiations on the pricing and so on. But we did it because we believe that that's the only way to go by building local capacity. So that was a big challenge. Bureaucracy was slow. Philippines is a country where there is regulation for microgrid, but nobody knows how to apply it. The methodologies and techniques to evaluate the cost benefit or the technical aspects of a project were not there. We provided that. Myanmar is a country where there is regulation coming, very good regulation, thanks to interventions of institutions like the World Bank. So yes, Myanmar is moving well. It might be even faster deploying microgrids than, for example, a country like Philippines that has a law, but where the bureaucracy behaves more like an obstacle or is an obstacle rather than a solution to the problems of 11 million people out there.
So we already had some discussion about the islands, and we saw already some differences between the European and also the Asian cases. Maybe on focusing on the Indonesian cases, maybe it's interesting to extend discussion that direction.
Yeah, thank you. I work a lot in Southeast Asia, especially in Indonesia, and also with the younger generation. And when I was the first time in Indonesia, I realized Indonesia is like Europe. It's Europe, the size. I think when you look to the future, then also we see a lot of economical growth. And a huge energy sector, but most of it is conventional. And then when you talk with the younger generation, I think Unisar is one of these younger generation employees, they are very into renewables. Yeah, when I give a guest lecture at Technical University Delft, it's always a nice audience, but there is much more hunger and interest when I give a similar guest lecture in Jakarta. I think Unisar, I think maybe it's also good to tell about yourself and about your peers, how you look to that energy transition in Indonesia and why you're here and not in Jakarta. Mm-hmm. But I expect you will go back there.
Yeah, I'm actually working at the moment as a technical engineer in here. I graduated from TU Delft, Sustainable Energy Technology Program. And yeah, I'm in here. I'm quite honored with Nikos. To discuss microgrid, because one of our course we use a book that Nikos wrote, so it's an honor for me as well. Yeah. And I also actively involved in several social initiatives in Indonesia, and we do research and see the Indonesian landscape at the moment and how we bring the energy transition into a better way. And indeed, I actually agree. We share the same view with Atem regarding the current condition in Southeast Asia, particularly in Indonesia. If you see in Indonesia, we have like more than 16,000 islands. And then if you look closer in the electricity infrastructure, more than 60% are the installed capacity are concentrated in Java and Bali. This is one of the biggest cities in in Jakarta. It is leading to a social problem where everybody from outside Java want to go to Java because to experience a more better living because the electricity infrastructure is there. Well, the other region, no. In fact, there's 12,000 villages that has no electricity or limited access to electricity. And then if we see that it's a big problem here because we cannot even build the power plant because we tend to use a coal-based power plant in an island. Because if we want to build that, it will take 1,000 megawatt capacity. Well, the demand is only 5 until 10 megawatt, particularly in island. So the challenge is how we create the power plant based on the island's potentials. As Nico said, we have a lot of technologies currently available here, from renewable until the energy storage. It can help to mitigate or to have the energy access in these islands. So and then the challenge would be particularly in Indonesia is we tend to have like a fossil fuels. We depend on the fossil fuels. And then if you see in the remote area, the remote island, I went there last year. I went in the northern island of Jakarta. It's 4 hours by boat, and they in that island they use a diesel generator, and then they only have 4 hours electricity a day. And if there's a storm, the people cannot transport the diesel fuel
for several
days, and there will be a blackout in the island. So there's a transportation problem aside from if we're not even talking about the environment at this moment. So, and the second one is improving weak and small electricity network. Because if we see like small islands tend to have like a small grid, well, one power plant, one generator down, it will affect to the entire grid. Therefore, batteries needed, any kind of energy storage that support the grid, that small grid should be needed. And the third one is producing a stable and warranted electricity, where oftenly the government will see the warranty of the system.
Yeah.
So this and the last one would be the affordable electricity. So the focus right now it's actually the people on the bottom of pyramid, if we're talking the development in Indonesia. So if you see this rural electrification, it's actually a serious problem in Indonesia. And if we take into account if we use the microgrids and if we use all renewable energy, it can be have like a 6.2 billion euro of investment to tackle that one. So it looks small, like small islands. But if we see that as a whole, it's a really big business.
Yeah.
And the challenge would be like Atem said, the system in Indonesia, the decision maker, the government. Yes, there's such the problem of the system in Indonesia. But however, as our community see that we can hack the system, we can also trick the system, because right now, if we are talking about the developing a power plant, we're talking about the trading the electricity.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in Indonesia, it's monopoly, like Atem said.
Yeah. You're the younger generation, eh? So I think it's also interesting. Eh? You're just at the beginning of your career. When you think 40 years ahead? Then maybe you're still working in the sector. How do you see the landscape then? Because I think that's really, we can look back, we can look today, but it's also good to look 40 years ahead.
Yeah.
How do you see that yourself?
So we see that there's currently, it's if we see the system, the government, there's a transformation between the fossil fuel minded to a more renewable energy. And I would like to take part of that one. And then it's not easy because people, there's a lot of connection because it's hard to change. People are reluctant or it's hard for to accept the change. And the thing that we can trick the system is some companies are already doing this in Indonesia where they don't build the power plant, but they built the integrated sector power plant, for example. Like you built the integration between agriculture sector into the in power plant. So they use, they operate the agriculture industry, but powered by renewable energy, where it can tackle the affordability challenge as well. And then one of my initiatives in Indonesia is also we are trying to make a processing center for agriculture in the eastern of Indonesia, where we see that a lot of potentials for cashews. So we would like to build the power plant to power the decentralized that processing center to process the cashew, and that gives the social impact first to the farmers, second one to the supply chain of the agriculture, and the third one is to help the energy transition in that island. So that would be the case for Indonesia. So,
so in fact, the industry is taking the lead on the very small size to implement those first more sustainable microgrids. That's in fact what you're saying.
Yeah, indeed.
And what do you expect next after that?
So next, you mean the project or?
After the industry, like the cashew example you give, what could be the next step after that?
So that would be, first you we promote the, we call it productive use of energy that can give the impact or boost the economy of the region. And then you give the electricity to the region itself because they already have the affordability for that because the economy is boost. And then the next step would be to replicate that kind of concept to other islands that we see the potentials of that island. We built an integrated industry and the energy into one to boost that the economy of that island, and you gain also, the people gain also the economy and can afford this microgrid electricity as well.
It's very interesting.
Thank you. Maybe it's also good to go back to Simon, I think, when we see these developments in Asia, but also see developments in Europe. What can we learn from each other, Simon?
So I think in general, working in Europe or even across Europe, what soon you find out is that each island will be specific and very different and require sort of a tailored approach. I think also islanders, there's this big sense of identity that's linked with islands, which has a strong impact on the way that you will need to bring projects. And that's why the social aspect or this technology acceptance is very important, I think, related to working with microgrids on islands. But I think everything that I've heard here about the Asian context, in fact, there's big parallels that we can draw. And especially if I talk now representing the Clean Energy for EU Islands Initiative and the Secretariat, this perspective of considering technologies and clean energy transition not as a pure technical transition where we say, okay, we kick out fossil fuels and we go now to something more more CO2 neutral, is that in fact this transition we consider as a much bigger social evolution as well for these island regions. So I think here microgrids on islands, just because solar and wind power, the costs have come down so much, is that they can bring net benefits to these power systems that now run on diesel. And that, of course, can bring much bigger socioeconomic benefits to the islands. I think maybe something that's not been mentioned and that we do find see very much in Europe as well is the impact on tourism. So, for example, if I'm talking about the Scottish islands just now, for them, this 100% renewable power is a big driver to draw tourists to the island, saying, like, look, you can come visit a remote island that's completely sustainable. And that's, in fact, a big incentive for the islands, because in many instances, the stakeholders that are present on these islands are linked with tourism. So these are hotel owners, and they are interested to put their money in a project that will improve the public image or sort of be good for advertising and so on. So I think that's a very big driver. Then, Atem, what you mentioned on ownership is very important. And also related to the legal barriers, that's something that here in Europe is also definitely something that we see. In many cases, islands are protected for nature, so which means that there's many, or even also so cultural heritage, for example, in Italy, that's a very big thing, basically meaning that you're unable to change anything about the island. So then if you come with a technology such as a wind turbine, even if it's small, in many cases you're not able to go through the permitting, or it's not possible.
Yeah.
So I think in conclusion, the big lines between the two contexts that we've seen, they run quite parallel. But I think in the details, of course, we see that there's quite some differences.
Yeah. I've got also a question from the audience for you. Can microgrids thrive under energy monopolies, as they are there, I'm not sure, as found in Indonesia?
Sorry, once more?
Can microgrids thrive under energy monopolies, as found in Indonesia? I'm not sure if they're there. You maybe respond on that first. But is it something which is a barrier?
For me, I see that it's more into microgrid could be more into the affordability perspective. So how people can afford this system, but we do have like a system installed in the island nearby Borneo. It's called Berau Island. It has a big potential for tourism, and this. I'm not sure whether this is already a smart microgrid or not, but it has a hybrid project. It includes the solar PV, battery, micro hydro with the genset backup with a total capacity of 1.2 megawatt with a storage of 2.1 megawatt hour. Mm-hmm. It is already operated right now by the beginning of 2019. And then it give the electricity for 1,700 individuals in that island. So it's actually up there. And then it's supported. The thing is, it is supported by the U.S. Agency, but it is operated by the PLN, by the monopoly company.
I think in general you can say that transport distribution companies have a little bit mixed feelings when it's about microgrids. And I think we'll come back later to that when we talk about commercial and industrial applications. But what I see in Indonesia, some areas, the PLN see challenges to go there, and then of course when there is a local operator that wants to take care of a microgrid, I think that's a good solution.
Yeah,
and that's not typical Indonesia. I think you see similar things in Europe. There you also see that grid operators, they have, I see microgrids also a little bit like IPP, and there are always mixed feelings when it's about IPP and the grid operator.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's good to realize that. So
we have time left for a last question for you, for your panel.
Yeah, I think we are here with Paul on the table. A lot of innovations. Where do we see innovations looking to the future? Simon, maybe to start with you, maybe short. Where do you see innovations? What innovations will really help that energy transition on islands?
So I think here in terms of innovations, but this goes generally also for larger grids. I think it's happening behind the meter, or sort of getting closer into people's homes and sort of harvesting what's there in terms of production and consumption, but also, for example, in terms of flexibility. These things are very important for mainland grids, but I think because of the more stringent flexibility requirements for island systems, that's also definitely something that you need to be harvesting in the future. Once you go to sort of this paradigm shift from a hybrid system where you have a diesel backup, where you hybridize with a bit of solar or with wind, to these fully renewable systems, where in fact you don't even have the diesel anymore, but you work with batteries and sort of an optimally sized system with multiple solutions. So I think that's where I see quite some potential.
Nikos?
Yeah, I basically agree with Simon. Just let me say that there are different motivations for the migrants in separate parts of Asia and also perhaps Indonesia. You see that rural electrification and perhaps support of the wind is the main motivation. While in Europe now you see more diesel offset in islands, and also flexibility as well as energy communities empowerment. So migrants now are used to support energy communities, and that's a very important European development.
Yeah.
That, as Simon said, basically the engagement of customers, consumers, load management, and also renewable penetration, almost 100% are the basic next steps that we need to push.
Yeah, thank you. And Atom, in one sentence, where you see innovation?
Well, simple, in two directions, technology innovation, a mix of sources and remote control. I can see on my cell phone in Singapore how the electricity demand and supply goes, which source is active and which source isn't active, etc. So we see that more. My vision is to guide our company towards full remote control and switch off when you don't pay, switch on when you pay. That's where the technology goes. Business model innovation, we see where the way you structure financing to make something affordable. If you do not bring in the business models in the game, you can't do microgrids. So it is both have to work together to get a sustainable operation of microgrids done. So technology and business model, the financial engineering of the piece of technology with the kind of people you are trying to service. And I don't think protected areas or environment will be restrictions. On the contrary, microgrids is a beauty. Go down in Palawan, it's a tourist area, and witness yourself how many people stop over there to make photos of the plant and spread the word that it can be done. It is not science fiction.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Your last sentence.
It's already mentioned by all of the panelists where the innovation would be, there are two type of innovation. One is the technology innovation derived from researchers, from the technology implementers. And the second one would be the business model innovation that can hack the system, whether if we face the boundaries from bureaucratics, then we can always trick the system so it can be beneficial for every stakeholders.
Yeah. Thank you so much. There's room for a short conclusion for maybe 10 seconds and maybe to already help you. I hear the word tourism often.
Yeah.
I think it's really interesting from the session. That's what's your conclusion in one sentence?
My conclusion in one sentence. I think, it's a very interesting development. Yeah. And also when you look to the bigger challenge where the world is standing for, the global transition, then we can learn a lot from islands and remote areas.